Please welcome your host, Matt Andrews. Welcome to the UK's biggest gaming festival, where thousands of gamers have traveled from all over the world to join us here at Insomnia 55. We have an expo hall, we have celebrity meet and greets, we have an enormous LAN with thousands of gamers, and here in our esports arena we have some fantastic esports matches brought to you by LG and Multiplay. We are very proud to present for you now our Heroes of the Storm final! Two teams have fought their way here through opposite sides of the bracket. We're very excited to have them meeting here for our final for a share of our £5,000 prize pool. Neither team dropped a map, not a single map in all of their tournaments, making their way to this final. And across this best of five, we're expecting fireworks and a lot of action to see who will be our Heroes of the Storm finalists. Please welcome E-Girls of the Storm and Reason Gaming. As I say, neither team dropped a single map in all of the rounds prior to this final. It's going to be a very exciting clash between the two of them. And to take you through all the action of this best of five, trying to win our £2,500 top prize, it's over to our casters, Axville and Mr. G.
Hello, welcome. Welcome back to the grand final. As Matt said, nobody dropped a map. Really, really excited. Excited for this final, so should we get underway, get the drafting started?
Yeah, let's get the draft started. Okay, it looks like the first map was going to be Blackheart Bay.
Which we didn't see in the semi-finals.
No.
It's an interesting map. The mechanics are very, very strong. You hand in the coins, the ghost pirate, the ship comes out, launches a huge barrage of cannibals towards your opponent's fortifications, and it can win a game single-handedly. You can effectively play PvE, or you can never engage in a fight and still win the game.
Yeah, if you end up going... If you commit to something that you shouldn't commit to, and then you lose cannons after cannons after cannons, you will just lose the game.
Yeah.
And you really need to be on point to make sure that that doesn't happen, and to make sure that, you know, it's kind of an attrition-based thing. You have to stay
definitely.
On point. You have to be sure you get coins, and then chests, and then mercenary camps all add up to coins, so you can really start fulfilling the objectives consistently.
Yeah, and I mean, I remember a short time ago when mules were decent, there'd be mule strategies trying to heal up all the buildings, stop that going. You'd have Tassadar picked intentionally to shield buildings, but now Tassadar's fallen off, mule's not as good, so we'll see how the teams deal with huge mechanic of this ghost ship. So getting into the draft now.
Yes.
E-Girls are getting the first ban.
Yep.
And hence first pick. Mm-hmm. Will we see the Zeratul ban first?
Usa!
Usa ban.
Usa being banned first.
Wow. There we go. Cut through now, everyone can see it.
So Usa is the first ban. Now, why do you think they would do that?
Maybe a respect ban against Reason. I'm sure they've watched Reason's game. Reason has favoured the Usa of what we've seen. And then there's the Zeratul ban, which means the E-Girls can pick up the Kale fast.
Damn it! Still no Zeratul game.
I don't think we'll ever get one.
No. It's going to be a while.
He's got to be banned.
Oh, he has to be.
So maybe respect ban with Yutha means E-Girls open to get Jaina, open to get Johanna, open to get Leoric, open to get Kael'thas.
Zagara and Azebo, really big picks.
Yeah,
right,
I mean,
Reason's
been favouring banning out Zagara.
Yes, they have.
So maybe.
Well, Zeratul's open, you have to ban Zeratul.
So E-Girls actually go for Leoric, which opens up that Jaina Kael'thas double mage combo.
Leoric is a very strong pick on this map. First pick lock in Leoric, not a problem with that at all.
No. But I wonder how Reason will respond to this.
I wouldn't be surprised to see a Warrior Assassin pick.
Yeah.
I would probably expect to see a Johanna and maybe one of the mages.
We have a Zagara. I was going to say Johanna Kael'thas seems very likely, but we're actually going to get the Johanna Zagara pick up here, which still leaves the double mage.
Yes.
Because consultated. We talk about this combo all the time. It's one of the strongest combos possible as far as a ranged assassin, they both do huge burst damage.
So much damage.
Huge burst damage.
But the Zagara is very strong.
Yes.
The zoning potential of drop pods, of hunter killers, of even the Maw.
And on Blackheart's Bay in particular, you've got the top two lanes are quite close together. The bottom lane, real far apart. You leave a Zagara alone there and she will take your fort without any assistance.
Yes.
She will and dominate most 1v1s in the push front. And she can really, you know, force you into a bad spot. You have to go and deal with her, and then you're leaving the rest of your lanes.
And because our bottom lane tends to become a bit of an island in this map, taking a Zagara that can hold it and then contribute to team fights as the game continues is very strong. And of course, Kael'thas is not bad at holding lanes.
No, it's not bad at all. So we do actually get the Kael'thas with the Eagles, and then they quickly pick up the Rhaegar afterwards. Now, we've seen Reason in their second banning phase ban Rhaegar, both games that we cast in the semis for them. So it's reasonable that they would potentially want to pick up the Rhaegar, not risk it being banned this early on, because they've already got the Uther support banned. Eagles at this point might just ban out Malfurion.
They have banned out Abathur. Now, I am a massive fan of Abathur on this map. Yeah. The vents that are located around the boss allow for very easy body soaking, which is something that Abathur can really struggle to do on a lot of maps.
Yeah, and in conjunction with that, because they've got the Rhaegar, and they'll have another two picks, unless they ban out either the Abathur or the Illidan, they could go in on that strategy.
Yes, they could.
And that's a very, very strong one to do. Abathur, obviously giving Illidan the bonus attack speed, the shields, and contributing damage, and then Rhaegar with the big Ancestral.
Banning the Jaina.
So get a ban on Jaina. I think I maybe would have preferred a ban on a support, like a Malfurion, something a bit... force them into maybe a lower tier one. But taking out the Jaina means they don't have that super high ranged assassin.
Yeah.
With the Zagara, because obviously Zagara does a lot of damage with the Hunter Killers. They do.
Zagara will rip through your team.
So Zagara Jaina would be a scary damage lineup to be against. So we'll see how that goes.
With the Rhaegar here, and with the lack of Uther to kind of counter him, you have always got that ancestral healing. So someone on your team, if played correctly, which I imagine it will have to be killed twice.
Yes. Now, do you reckon Reason will kind of counterpick Rhaegar with a Tyrael? Because if you judgment the Rhaegar and blow him up, there's no Ancestral because he can't cast on himself if he's dead.
Exactly.
Or if he's stunned out for all of
that. So taking a dive comp here, or kind of manipulating it into a dive comp, wouldn't be a bad choice.
Yeah, because as we've seen, Johanna and Tyrael function very well together.
And for the first time today, we get to cast in the Zeebo game.
Yes, I mean, he's super, super popular just in general. And he's not... ridiculously strong, but he's just good. He has a good skill set and some fantastic plays can be made. A lot of people picking up Ravenous Spirit these days over Gargantuan.
The nerfs were reverted, so it's back to being viable. Yes. He's been featured a lot in the recent tournaments that we've seen around the globe, really. Just in Zeebo.
Highest pick rate, isn't it?
Yes, the highest pick rate across multiple tournaments.
Teams don't tend to spend a ban on him because he's not really one of those heroes you want to focus on not allowing.
He's just short of the horribly power pick, but he's in that range where it's really good, and he just has so much utility that in a game like this where it's going to revolve around landing big abilities, Nazebo is going to be really nice pick.
We actually have effectively three ranged assassins. Nazebo and Zagara are specialists, but they function as good damage dealers. That's a lot of push, actually. Nazebo pushes quite hard.
Nazebo can hold a lane on his own. They all can hold a lane kind of solo.
Which means Reason Gaming is going to look up to pick their support final. Yes. Probably Karazim or Malfurion. Now, we could see Eagles actually go for a double support composition.
Take the Karazim away, maybe.
Take the Karazim away, because Karazim puts out good damage. We don't even have to see Divine Palm. Seven-Sided Strike can bolster that, but take that opportunity away from Reason, and they're forced with the Malfurion, and I don't think Tranquility is a particularly good healing ultimate for their squishy Nazebo and Vala.
I'm a massive fan of Karazim Rhaegar, because Karazim has that Deadly Reach Transcendence combo, where he just brings everyone's health up a little bit, and then you have Rhaegar with the Chain Heal and then the Ancestral Healing to really top someone off if they're incredibly
I think what
low.
I would have loved to see would have been Karazim and Illidan, but we do have the Falstad out. I mean, could you imagine with a Feral Leap, everybody just jumps in on one target and then they're terrifying, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
You've got a wolf running at you and Monk and then...
Oh, I like that.
Oh, wow. A double tank combo composition.
So how would you call this? Because they have a lot of, like, lockdown... They have a lot of initiate in the form of, like...
I think that's a... Go on, pick Malfurion, I dare you. really think it'll be a web wrap game if they pick Malfurion, and then no matter what he does, just web wrap the Malfurion, and that's the healing.
Yeah.
Out. Done. Bit. Or a long range web wrap on Ravenous Spirit if it comes out.
You have dared them, and they have accepted.
Yes.
So
we'll see. I think I prefer Eagles draft in this particular one.
Yeah, I like Falstad on this map. The ability to hop to chests, to mercenary camps, or even to the turning point is incredibly strong.
I
really like the Anubarak Initiate also, because you can kind of predict where they're going to be, because the map is small but condensed.
But it's not just the Nubarak tank. You have that Lyuric. Yeah, you on have top that. Of that. He's so strong. You get that, like that baseline. He's in your face. He'll always be there.
You have that wall.
Yeah.
In the Lyuric, and you have the Nubarak to really kind of open opportunities, which is incredible. And then of course you've got the Kael'thas and the Falstaff that will take full advantage of those opportunities.
Yeah,
so I really do like Eagle's draft in this one. But I am excited to see in the Zeebo game, and I do think Valor is very strong, and maybe with a few outplays, shall we say, the Malfurion may be able to juke the Anubarak for just long
maybe,
enough.
Maybe. It'd be good to see. So yeah, we're getting into our game number one. That's on Black Hearts Bay. Fantastic finals. Hopefully we've got this best of five lineup for you. Reason?
Someone's about to drop a game.
Yeah, somebody's about to drop their first map of the tournament. And let's make sure it's all set up. Yep, we have Eagles on the left. I'll introduce them very quickly. We're going to have Sherez on the Anubarak. Shaw is going to be playing that Falstad. Lanaldel Cray is on the Rhaegar. Clued playing that Kael'thas. And Myth is on that Lyoric.
And for reason, we have Skibber on the Johanna, we have Invayne on the Nazebo, we have Miagus on the Valar, and we have Slamjam on the Malfurion, and finally we have Siege on the Zagara. Call for a pause.
There we go. Maybe some technical issues going on.
Yeah, just a few technical difficulties, a little bit of lagging, it happens. People are scared.
Yeah, it's great. As we can see, we have a Zagara on the bottom lane, as predicted. Going to be, by the looks of it, facing up against the Lyoric. How do you think that matchup's going to go? Because I think Lyoric's going to struggle.
Oh, it's a good first kill on the Kael'thas.
Woo!
So, the chests have spawned. The chests have spawned. It looks like that Reason Gaming are going to be able to secure this reasonably easily. That is a very good turnaround.
I see what you did there. Okay.
It looks like that we're going to go to my cam just for a second here, so no worries about that. So, what happened, again, apologies for the technical difficulties, it looks like it's all sorted now. So, at the moment here, what we see Reason Gaming just kind of committing to getting all these chests, which is reasonable, but Zagara's taking a lot of damage here. Any little more well played, because that was a very good kill from the Falstaff. Landed a couple of skill shots and got a few more autos off and managed to really secure that kill.
Oh yeah, definitely. We're going to have a Anubarak actually getting rooted in the top. Able to Burrow Strike himself away.
Good escapability. Meanwhile, Kael'thas and Valor are going to have an entertaining lane here, I imagine. We need to keep an eye on bottom lane though, because Lyoric versus Johanna is going to be very explosive. Good power throw there from the Falstad. This lane is going to get sieged, and sieged surprisingly hard. Surprisingly quickly as well.
Yeah, we've got we do have a multi-shot build coming out of Valor, so the creep wave, or so far the multi-shot build. So far, those creep waves are going to be clearing out nice and easily in the mid lane. But we've got Kael'thas and Rhaegar.
Valstad's flying into mid.
Clearing out the Bloom camp, getting those necessary coins.
Yes, yes.
Ooh. Now remember, this map is all about getting those doublooms, handing them in to this big ghostly pirate guy. You guys can't see him because I'm longer the cameraman. But
this guy.
Yeah. And then
this is Blackheart.
As you can see, 10 coins for the first hand in. You get that huge barrage of cannibals coming down.
Down
on the
bottom here, you can see Eagles put the score. Eagle and Reason Gaming score. Apologies for that. And so at this stage, it's just very kind of. Blackheart's play tends to get this way. If no team secures the first cannons, they tend to have this
stagnation.
Yes. I wouldn't exactly call it a lull, but it's the same in every game. Because of the nature of Blackheart's play, you have a very explosive start, and to the mid game, by comparison, appears to be very slow. Yeah. But it's actually no slower than you see in most other games.
Yeah, it feels slow because the top two lanes are close together, and the objective is, the first objective tends to happen much later, unless one team has a significant advantage. And it's just mostly due to nature. Once a team will hit level 10 first, or when both teams hit level 10, there'll be a big fight with all the ultimate storm abilities, and that will decide who has the upper hand in this game, who gets the first hand in, and the momentum. Occasionally, we can even have full-on 5-on-5 wipes, depending. Could we got Zagara with Hunter Killers maybe to finish off the last?
Yeah, the five-man wipe on both teams, a 10-man wipe, can happen. Hopefully it won't, because that does mean that we have a minute where nothing happens. We're just like, so, look at these trees.
It's like, look, Lyoric's going to get ready to pick up all the coins.
Yes, Lyoric.
So a small experience advantage on the side of Eagles.
Yes, they've done well in the lanes. Obviously, this is just from getting lanes and getting a few Siege Giants, and of course, getting the hard camp.
They're getting their mercenaries a bit more efficiently. I mean, get the hard camp over for Reason Gaming, but they've not actually touched their Siege Giants.
Well, it looks like Johanna's going to be trying to pick up the knights and is doing successfully and getting a few coins in the process. So, at this stage, with the talents being the way they are, it's kind of about, and it looks like big turn in there is going to be the first cannons will go over two eagles, and this will focus down the mid fort.
Just as that second set of chests spawn, which is very good, really timing. Important. Yeah, fantastic, especially since most of the lanes, or at least the bottom lane, are pushed in, which means Leoric and Kael'thas are going to be able to get that bottom chest in mid lane. Maybe a bit of an engagement as they try to push this forward.
So at this point, when the chests spawn, there tends to be a bit of an engagement, and forcing the cannons to spawn means that they can't retreat back into their fort. And that kind of edge means that you can secure a couple of kills. At this stage in the game, levels 6 to 8 and to 9, kills are so good.
Yeah, once you get that level 7 talent all the way up to 9, those kills necessary to hit that level 10 first. They've got a cannon handed already, like I said, for Eagles, which has put them almost a full level ahead of Reason Gaming. So much so, but if you look at the coin totals, it doesn't appear on yours, we've got 11 coins in total currently being held, sorry, now 13 for Eagles, and similarly 13 on the side of Reason Gaming. So Reason, both teams can get a full hand in, and we're going to have Kael'thas and Lando Rey both with 6 coins handing in the full 12 necessary.
Mm. So this is going to be the round 2 of coins going over to Eagles. This is really good play from Eagles so far. And basically what this means is that they get a very nice early kind of cushion. They gain a decent amount of experience just from taking a few cannon towers and that kind of stuff.
Oh yeah, definitely. Now that, because we've had two hand-ins, we've got the fort in mid is dead. The fort at top is taking a lot of damage, or at least will do from this barrage. It's going to be hit by actually the 6, or at least 5. Five or 4 onto that fort. And that's going to really, really lower its health. They've got level 10 now, Eagles do.
Yes.
That's the all-important level 10. They don't have the cannons for the later game when it's cheaper to necessarily get damage on keeps or even the core, but they have this early game advantage to try and press and get a bit more done now that they have the ultimates. Now is when they want to look for an engagement, and quite frankly, we're not seeing them search for it.
Well, with Anubarak and with Falset and with Leoric, you have a lot of power ults.
We have a little attempt at Anubarak top lane. Johanna is actually holding 13 coins, you see there.
Oh, so really?
Yeah.
So the Johanna currently is dealing with 13 coins. That's a lot of coins. Basically, this makes Johanna a very juicy target.
Yeah,
for
she is also the hardest
anyone.
Target to kill. Quite easily the hardest target to kill for Reason.
She will absolutely wreck everyone if... Well, she won't wreck everyone. She will make everyone get wrecked.
Yeah, obviously... The solo tank, the solo Doom warrior's
turn it in
role
very successfully. Well done.
Is to soak all the damage. Oh, actually, we're going to have Leoric caught out here.
The Wraithhawk will be fine. This is a 3v4 here. I'm not sure how much they want to fight this. Wow. They have the other one, the March of the Black King, used to escape. You don't
phenomenal
often see
play,
that.
Yeah, because you're unstoppable during
yes,
it.
You
so
are.
That second wave of Reign of Vengeance didn't actually stun him out. Great play. Use your initial.
I wouldn't have thought to do that. That's a great
high level play from Eagles coming out there. That's really flawless execution. And we've got a boss attempt.
No way. They're going for the boss with no advantage. This is brave. If Reason Gaming sniff that this is happening and come up here and they have their ults up, which they have some of them up, they can just absolutely wreck and get 3 kills.
They're heading up, I don't think they know.
They're not committing to the defense here. This is going to be a free grab. This is going to really catch them off guard.
Fantastic.
Very well done there from Eagles. This really puts the whole game up on its head.
And then suddenly three heroes come out from the boss thing. Johanna's having to really retreat. She did get manage to hand in, so she's down to 3 coins. Not the juicy target that she was.
No.
I mean, they've got a boss. The fort's already dead. Now there's only one fort remaining down in bottom lane.
It looks like Eagles for a second, they were doing the classic, let's have a party in the bush tactic.
And it's always a good one. In fact, they're trying to take their hard camp, but Leoric just comes in, bullies them out. Eagles are going to steal the hard camp from
Reason
Gaming.
Steals the hard camp as well. This is spiraling. This is really going downhill for Reason Gaming. They need to regroup and regroup fast. The good Phoenix there, but a good stun on the back there.
Oh, huge
Inzalan blast.
Malfurion got erased from the game.
Really, really impressive shot there.
And he had nowhere to run, nowhere to hide from
Great ancestral healing there. Rhaegar casting on himself, meaning he just definitely stays alive. The Ravenous Spirit is doing serious work. Finally gets interrupted by the new rank. Meanwhile, Valor's getting awfully low, but not low enough yet to really go for a kill secure.
Yeah, the boss has been cleaned up, which means that Eagles are looking to retreat. They are backing up. Nice
chest
and safe.
Chest of spawn. This is perfect for Eagles. They can pull back right to the chest, get 2 free chests, 10 coins, and then retreat.
Off bottom, able to get that one.
And look for another advantage in a few minutes.
I mean, they currently have 19, 20, probably 26 coins by the end of this, once all chests are picked up. 23.
And they can even swing down here and grab the middle hard camp if they want to. I'm not sure how much of an idea, how much of a good idea that is.
Yeah, especially being so split up.
Yes.
Four stars, seven coins, juicy target. But
oh, they've all come down here. They're trying desperately to get a kill on this
retreat
guy.
Retreat behind the wall.
Yes. And don't good get play. Anything for that reason, gaming.
Meanwhile, Lanners are crazy, handing in 12 coins.
Oh, Reason Gaming just seem to be a step behind. They just seem to be getting places just a second too late. And in the time that they're earning themselves, Egos, they're managing to get just a massive lead. And they're going to get a pick here on the Nazebo.
They
and
get
that's just,
the hand in as well. On
they got a hand in and they got a pick on the Nazebo. This is just really going downhill fast for them. The attacking route is going to land on someone. But it is going to be able to secure a kill. The Malfurion getting awfully low here. This is a 5 versus 3. Great
web
there.
There's the Webber at.
Surely he's dead.
Coming
he's
in.
Dead, right? Oh, great. He's going to blast again. Knocks on something, they managed to pick up Zagara. And the Varangmore will keep
body blocks on the Johanna. The back.
Oh, Johanna dies as well! And they can get loads of coins that Johanna had left over.
Lana Ducrey on that Rhaegar, just doing what he wants. Happily picking up those coins.
Ridiculous.
17 coins in total for the side of E-Girls, now up to 19. They can get another hand in straight away. And this
and this turn in will do some serious damage.
It'll be the middle keep because they've all got both towers down. Yeah. The gate is at half health.
That's
the middle keep and some structural damage.
And again, what they're doing? They need to come here and defend this. Reason Gaming need to come down here and stop them doing this. They can't let them hand in much more.
They got that early boss, so the wall's also completely gone top.
Yeah.
So it could also be a lot of damage done to top keep.
They're having to scramble to try and defend this.
I mean, such a shame because we've said like the drafts are both. Very, very strong equally. It's just this two warrior composition coming out, and the Anubarak, not the most common warrior pickup, but that web wrap, we saw it there doing such good work. Isolates one target, and then that target's basically dead. The team either have to commit to saving that person or cut their losses and
yeah,
abandon.
and try and flee and try and make the most out of it. But it looks like, again, they're trying to turn in once more.
And we have level 16 just come out.
Rhaegar's a little bit overextended, shouldn't be too bad
Johanna's
though.
In a bad
the Johanna's
been body blocked
by the Rhaegar. No, just in range of Tranquility. Web Cocoon on the Tranquility means that Johanna should definitely fall. Our Fury's been stuck in this, no one's going to be able to get him out. Valor gets picked off, Johanna gets picked up instantly. The Tranquility's up, but everyone else is dead. Very nice play there from Eagle securing.
The Rhaegar was taking a huge amount of damage, but he waited until the last moment to get his Ancestral on himself, because he was the one body blocking the Johanna, stopping her escape. The Anubarak burrowed in from behind. And they know they're not going to kill her.
Ooh.
Huge Hinterlands Blast come out. Ice Block from
the Ice Block from Malfurion, but that is going to secure the kill. Forcing the Ice Block to secure the kill is just as good as getting the kill yourself.
During all of that action, all of that excitement, Falstad still hasn't picked his level 16 talent. Finally hit level 17 and gets Hammer Time.
Hammer Time. And this is going to be a dead lower key. There's nothing they can do to stop this.
Yeah.
They have 20 seconds that they need to hold out
They've
before they can really start a defense.
They've got all the coins. Or any coins being held are being held by E-Girls right now. It is only 12, it's not the full hand in, they need 18. But the tower's down
they're
the top, it's
hurt.
Literally just the keep.
They're just going to be like, all right, see you later.
Yeah, they're just gone. Maybe take some mercenaries. Bosses respawning in 20 seconds, that's a good objective for them to go for.
They can advance up, grab the hard camp, and then advance even further and grab the boss. And then maybe Reason can defend it. But they're 14, they're three levels behind. They haven't got the 16 talents. I'm not sure how wise it would be to fight here.
Yeah, I mean... you saw how effective that web wrap was on the Tranquility. It just absolutely nullified all of Malfurion's healing potential during that fight. Because not only because it was his ultimate not doing anything, but he wasn't able to support his team in any way, shape, or form with the roots or just with straight up with the regrowth.
See, what are Reason Gaming doing here? I imagine they're trying to maybe stabilize the lower lane, but at the cost of a boss. Or maybe a boss.
They must know this is happening. They know that the boss is coming
out. They don't have the watchtower. The only thing they have that tells them this is this minion wave, which is really far behind.
Yeah.
So this should be grabbed. They can't get up there quick enough anymore.
And it's not as if E-Girls even hit this particularly well. I mean, there was no vision of it, but you can see Falstad is just heading up there. There's nowhere anybody else on the map. I mean, even mid lane's pushing in, and they're not there pushing with it. They're just going to use this boss, take this top keep, and this might even be a push to win.
Well,
at this point, they're three levels ahead, almost four.
Yeah.
There still are talent points ahead. I mean, Reason are close to getting their level 16. But this keep's gone, and the boss will be full
dead.
Health by the time the
keep's boss gonna, and they have Nike shoving this.
Yeah.
And it forces everyone to Hearthstone back, as they all realize alarm bells have rung, and now they're trying to get it.
The boss isn't even there. He's still lagging behind. Look,
yeah, the boss is going to arrive here. They're going to have to try and defend this Nike camp, and by the time they manage to do so, taking all the poke damage, while defending this,
Zagara
gets caught out here. Good little kill there. It's great. That's gonna be a massive advantage.
And I think that basically signs it.
Oh, great march for the Black King. That's gonna force Ziba away.
Boss is still going. Vala's gonna get
lamp up there.
Vala and Zagara dead. Boss is still there. That's a GG. Yeah, super fast.
Incredibly well played by Ego. Just outmaneuvering them every turn.
Yeah, every turn. That sneaky boss at the start really set them up for that fantastic game.
Yeah.
I can't really fault them on that. I think
they just outmaneuvered them.
I slightly favoured their draft because of that Nubarak web wrap. It came out super strong. It showed why it was good.
It was like a pre-counter. It was really good. Yeah.
Yeah. No, definitely. So we're gonna get this next game underway as quick as possible for you, and we'll get the draft in. You send all the links.
Yeah. I'm working on it.
Next map is Cursed Hollow, which was a pick by Eagles. The first map, Blackheart's Bay, I was there when they were doing all the map choosing and vetoing. And when Reason Gaming picked Blackheart's Bay as the first map, Eagles were like, no, we're not a big fan of Blackheart's Bay. But they really came through. They dominated. There's not really much more we can say about it.
Yeah, they did really well. Again, it was just outmaneuvering them at every turn. Every time Reason Gaming tried to do something, Eagles were just... They were either not there and doing something more important, or they were just there.
They were either one step ahead, like you say, not there, doing something more important, like the boss or the hand-ins. I'm almost surprised they got that first hand-in as quick as they did. After we talked about how you normally wait till level 10, they got it just before level 10, hit level 10 with that, won a fight, got a second hand-in.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's not really much more. That's how you play it. They got a small advantage, turned it into a huge advantage, and just snowballed with it.
Yeah.
And we saw with the four hand-ins that they got how strong that Blackheart cannons from the ghost ship are. It just absolutely demolishes the forts and the keeps. And for those who don't know, if you take down just one tower of the forts initially, because they've got more health as you go back, if you take out one tower or the gate in any of the lanes, one barrage will completely destroy the fort.
Yes, so and that's a great threshold to cross. Yeah. So now we're moving on to Cursed Hollow.
Yep.
And we are going to go straight into the draft phase here.
Is already up.
Yes.
Good job. Efficient.
And Cursed Hollow is a very interesting map. If you've been following the games today, you will have seen this played a couple of times, I think. Two times? Something like that. It's not important.
Yeah, no, Cursed Hollow was played twice.
Yeah. If you've seen it played before, you'll understand that this is quite possibly one of the most explosive maps on the rotation, shall we say.
Yeah, because it's such a huge map and there's such massive space between the lanes. The rotations are really important. If you don't see them coming, then that's it. You've got a whole lane where it's not easy for somebody to go and soak if there was a solo person laning. If you can't soak their lane, that's a huge amount of experience you're missing out on.
So it looks like that Reason Gaming are first banning Leoric. That's a brave pick.
Yes.
And as we can see here, E-Girls then ban out the Uther, which worked for them very well last game.
It's still that respect Uther ban, because they know that they love the Uther.
But they give Reason Gaming Zeratul.
And I think this is...
And on Cursed Hollow!
I know, it's one of his best maps. He's good on every map, but it's one of his best.
There's so many walls.
E-Girls, they pick up the Kael'thas and the Johanna straight away. Potentially would have liked to see the Jaina. Because if you burst Zeratul down, you get him in any sort of stun and he dies.
Leoric's banned. I don't think you can not take Johanna.
No,
that Leoric is out, you have to go with Johanna. You have to force them to take a awkward tank. Because Leoric and Johanna can just fit into everything.
They are the main two. I mean, Reason Gaming, they've still got the big Judgment Tyrael to pick up. They can still pick up Muradin with his Dwarf Toss and his Hammer Throw and all of that.
And we've yet to see a Muradin and Assassin or a Muradin and Warrior gank squad, and it's so effective.
Oh yeah, if you like Muradin Arthas.
Yes, Muradin Arthas.
It's so good. You Dwarf Toss over, surprise them, hit the stun, Arthas hits the roots, and then the other lane
just comes in and kills them.
Yeah, exactly.
It works. I've seen games where they've just demolished like 5-6 kills in the first 10 minutes doing this. So just like Reason Gaming are able to pick up the Jaina.
Yeah, smart pick. Obviously, they don't want to leave Jaina still as a ranged assassin.
Yeah, of course. Jaina
Reason have been banning out Zagara quite often, and they actually picked her up last game, favouring Jaina over Zagara this time, which was unlike the last game, so they favoured Zagara over Jaina.
I think on this map, Jaina's probably a little better, but I say that with Jaina's Blizzard, Cone of Cold, Summon Water Elemental, everything dies, it's amazing combo. And now that Water Elemental has been changed and arguably been nerfed to not deal any damage and not chill, it makes her burst combo significantly less effective.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, it was the constant chill from the watermelon elemental. I mean, the damage
you couldn't
really
run away.
Good, but yeah, that's exactly it. The damage was good, but it wasn't the main part. It's the infinite chill that really, really did it. And we're actually going to get fostered out. Really
I
good
really
for this
like this. I
for
really
this
like.
He can jump to the tributes. He can be anywhere. He's like a Brightwing, but he's still valid.
Yes, and all three of these heroes have slows.
Yes.
Which means that most of the time, E-Girls are not going to be running at full
and
speed.
E-Girls doing a smart thing, they're banning out the Muradin, the third most popular, the third most successful tank.
And Karazim gets banned out.
Oh. But, I mean, that's interesting for reason.
Yeah.
Because now E-Girls are just going to pick up the Rhaegar. They have to pick up the Rhaegar at this point.
They could pick up Malfurion and the Rhaegar.
Gone.
They have Kael'thas.
Yeah, they could pick both of them. And that means, what, Reason is stuck with Lili or Brightwing? If they go for the double support combo, it means they can go all in on a solo tank Johanna, and then maybe pick up a Zagara as their final damage.
And that's a crazy final pick to take.
Yeah. Even Tyrande with the Owls.
Yeah.
Extra support.
I wouldn't take two supports and Tyrande.
What, go three support?
I don't know,
those Owls.
You'll have no doubt. Jaina and Falstaff and Zeratul will just rip you to pieces.
I suppose,
you need that. Tyrande
is very,
very squishy. The Rhaegar and Uther as melee.
I suppose because I've got so much burst damage with the Falstaff, Jaina, Zeratul, a double support wouldn't necessarily be a bad idea.
No, it wouldn't at all.
Especially Malfurion, who can ice block. But we're going to get Abatha pick.
Abatha Johanna is crazy strong.
And the Illidan. Wow. Oh. So we're still waiting for the hard support. Reason could, on counter, pick up double support, but they wouldn't want that. They need a tank. And I think... what would they pick? Do you reckon they'll go with Tyrael?
Probably.
I mean, what are the other options? ETC?
ETC, Diablo?
Diablo, Chen, Anubrak, actually, that's a good choice. The others kind of blur. ETC could be very good, but I'd imagine
think ETC
Anubrak
would
or,
be very good.
I think Anubrak or Tyrael is most likely.
With this combo, with the Hinterland Blast, with Blizzard, and the Burst combo, Cleave.
You're all in on that Mosh Pit landing, though. We are going to get the Anubrak. It's a safer choice, I think.
Yes, it is a much safer choice. And against this team, they're going to be in your face. And the good Lili, I like the Lili pick here.
Reason picked Lili over Rhaegar, who is still in.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd imagine E-Girls pick the Rhaegar. That Ancestral on Illidan just does so much.
Yes.
And there it is. That is the pick.
It suits both teams.
I mean,
he's
like the best
them.
Healer for Illidan. Maybe the Monk, Karazim.
Yes, Karazim.
Like, they're pretty equal on that setting now.
But I do really, really like the Lili.
Yep, just getting into the lobby. Everything's good. We all ready? Oh, you not in?
Nope. If you would do me a favour. That's entirely my fault.
There we go. Now we are referees.
Yep, we are indeed.
We're all good. Okay, everyone's in.
So, how do you see this one going?
Oh, I mean, you can never, ever underestimate Illidan, Abatha. Combine that with any decent healer, specifically Rhaegar.
Mm-hmm.
You put Lightning Shield on Illidan and...
And then you have Abatha Shield on Illidan as well.
And then you've got Kael'thas in the background, just laughing and laughing and laughing.
Yeah. And it's just... It's one of those things that makes it incredibly difficult for the other team to do anything.
Yeah, no, definitely. So we're getting into the game now.
Yep,
on
just, loading in, just loading in now.
All players are ready. We've Cursed Hollow, our second map of this best of five for the grand finals of Heroes of the Storm, Insomnia 55 Open. Said that in the wrong order, doesn't matter. We've got E-Girls versus Reason Gaming. E-Girls, not necessarily surprising, because Reason Gaming are our top seed, but E-Girls taking that first map, dominating so.
E-Girls doing incredibly well this time.
And we're going to have E-Girls in blue on the left here. Myth is going to be playing that Illidan with Sherez on the Abatha, Master Abatha skin, lovely.
Brilliant.
Shaw going to be playing the Johanna. Lanel Del Cray on that Rhaegar, and Clued on that Kael'thas.
And on the red team for Reason Gaming, we have Falstad on the In Vain. That's the wrong way around. We have In Vain on the Falstad.
Yeah.
We have Skibber on the Zeratul. We have Siege on the Anubarak. We have Miegus on the Jaina, and we have Slam Jam on the Lili.
Yeah, so, I mean, just a basic lane setup so far. Everyone just kind of feeling out where they want to go. If you're going to send multiple heroes, I think the kind of polite agreement default is to send everybody bottom. You normally have 1-1-3 or 1-2-2, something like that. You have the least top. I don't know why that's the case. It's just kind of a polite agreement everybody's kind of gone with, even though this map is very symmetrical, unlike maps like Dragonshire, where it's actually better to have three bottles. Mm.
Do you feel that in order to make this Zeratul pick worth it, they need to get a kill in the first 2 minutes?
No, I think Zeratul is overly good. Well, not overly good, but I think he's so strong all game long.
Yes, he is.
He kind of falls off a little bit somewhere between 10 and 13. But as soon as he hits that 16,
I'm really surprised they took an Abathur into a Zeratul.
Yeah, I mean, Zeratul's a really good Abathur hunter.
Yeah, I mean, you don't really think about it because Zeratul doesn't really do it.
Oh, we have a
lane. Zeratul coming in.
Yeah.
A good little position there from the Illidan. Great juke there from the Singularity Spike. Is going to land to get away.
The evasion's blocking a lot of that right click damage coming out from the Falstaff, but all in all, not too bad. Bit of a good push happening bottom here for Eagles. They've taken a good chunk of the ammo and a bit of the health from the towers.
Yeah, they're doing that.
Kael'thas Rhaegar, Lightning Shield on Creep, for example, and the Living Bomb is really going to do some work. Illidan getting a bit aggressive on Falstaff, the Lightning Rod coming out, chunking him down. Abathur's not there.
Needs to be careful here. With a Zeratul about, as an Illidan, you have to get in people's faces. Your killing mobs isn't that good. Your killing creeps isn't that good. And if Zeratul turns up...
He's revealed himself in mid lane, the master of Zeratul, so you know, I'm actually going to have Illidan jumping onto Falstaff, taking super, super low. In vain, just about getting out there. Use the barrel roll.
Yeah, Illidan with an Abathur on him at this level is scary.
I mean, it's always scary, and the fact that they have the Illidan Abathur, and then on top of that, the Rhaegar, the best support for it.
Mm-hmm.
I am worried for Reason Gaming.
So it looks like Zeratul's going to come down to the lower lane. He wants to go after the Kael'thas, really.
I do. He's a very squishy target. He has less of an escape than Rhaegar, who can just pop into his Ghost Wolf. Instead of a mount, he has this.
Look at the fear that Zeratul instills. They don't know he's here. They know he's not anywhere else, but they don't know he's here. So they can't come further out of their lane. And that means they can't poke down these two.
Oh yeah,
and when you are Rhaegar and Kael'thas, you want to score some pokes. You want to be able to get some of that little damage off.
Right now, we have Abathur just, he's not even symbolic to anyone. He's just waiting and watching, waiting for that Zeratul gank to happen. As soon as it happens, he jumps on the target, gives him that shield, helps him out. That's like perfect play.
Who does this tribute spawn favor?
I mean, because the Falstaff's already here, I say it's an Eagle's favor if they rotate well.
I say it favors Reason, for this reason alone.
Yeah, Illidan's getting caught out.
The Illidan gets caught out. Zeratul, that's the power of Zeratul right there. And that'll
first
be first
blood. Goes to Reason Gaming. Illidan getting killed. I mean,
overextending.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if you've got Abathur on you. Abathur helps you survive with a tiny shield, but you need to not die. Yeah. Which sounds stupid, but you need to just not put yourself in a position that
you're
going
to get killed.
And
in the meantime, Abathur's gone to the bottom lane just to
body soak.
Yeah, do all that. And that's about it.
Yep.
First tribute going. In fact, Johanna's taken a lot of damage in mid, and she's going to fall down.
Great little kill there.
That's a big kill. She's a hard target to take
Jaina
down.
Jaina and Zeratul. You get the slows from the Jaina with the big burst, and then Zeratul...
Plus, Anubarak was there with all those stuns. Lili helped with a bit of blinding wind.
Yeah, he can just lock her down.
That was a four-man gank.
Four-man gank.
On the Johanna.
At this level, Johanna's
fantastic.
Not that difficult to kill. She's still difficult to kill. She's not, like,
but
level
despite
20.
Despite getting a tribute, and despite getting two kills, because they've had this Abathur soaking the lanes,
yes.
The experience difference is minute.
Absolutely
minute. If at all. And it doesn't matter. Both teams getting level 7, roughly the same time, level 7 talents. Although, we do have Reason
like
picking up a hard camp here.
Falstaff, just taking advantage there of Illidan's slight misstep with the slide, just hitting him with a few abilities. Little things like that are really what separates the good players from the great players.
Second tribute spawning down bottom.
I think this favors Eagles a lot more. But having said that, if Zeratul is allowed to get position and really go for something crazy.
I mean, his position right now is so good. He's watching if anyone comes from the bottom.
Kael'thas has to come this way, and then he gets completely blown up. He's not even looking to get killed.
No.
Like, in all honesty, he's not looking to kill someone. He's looking to make him low enough.
One
so
small combo, and he's Kael'thas is half health.
Oh,
half
this is a bad position. This is a really bad position for the Illidan to be in. If anyone comes up and helps Zeratul, the Illidan's dead. No one's coming to help him. Great blink away.
The Anubarak actually cancelling his channel. I think he's
as a result of that great play from the Illidan, Kael'thas has managed to come in, but Illidan himself is getting awfully low. Great shield bear there, knocking Zeratul out of the Illidan falls to a great
hit.
Play.
One Jaina Blizzard, then
Rhaegar getting killed there by the Beatles, apparently. Very well played. It looks like reason they're going to be able to secure this tribute.
Second tribute for them, four kills for naught.
Yes,
because of the Abatha, though, they look at the experience advantage. They still don't have an advantage, so Eagles are not out of this. Mm-hmm. Once the ultimates come in, Illidan gets a bit more tanky with a huge metamorphosis. Might even see the hunt, unlikely, but we could see it.
I don't like the hunt. I don't like the hunt. I think metamorphosis is just straight up better.
But in counter to that, we've got this Anubarak, and whilst he's a solo tank, so it's more likely, more common to see Locust Swarm. If you web wrap Illidan, that is most of the damage, because you put Illidan down, and that's Anubarak, Abatha and Illidan that are both out for a couple seconds.
Mm-hmm. Unless they know that's going to happen, and Abatha either waits or jumps on Johanna, because while Illidan's a great target to go on, Johanna's not bad either. Zeratul's in an awkward spot here. He knows that Johanna doesn't have shield clear, so he can kind of be a little cheeky with it. And he wants to get a kill here, but he wants to get a kill on the Rhaegar, at least get some damage off. The Abatha jumps in with the perfect time, really forcing Zeratul to come out of position. Blinks over the wall, but Anubarak does appear, and Jaina appears as well. Gets a big damage, Lili appears out of nowhere, and manages to secure a kill.
Yeah, those stuns, that rotation, fantastic. Great Jaina, she just kind of came in right from the end. Right from below, and just dropped down that blizzard.
That was a great blink from Zeratul. Realised that he wasn't going to win that fight, and got out of a really bad situation.
In the meantime, Zeratul's just going to take the tribute. This is going to be a curse for Reason Gaming.
Reason Gaming are 5-0 up in kills at the moment.
Yeah, this is the Reason Gaming that we've come to expect.
They're going for Johanna. They're diving her.
I don't think they'll get the kill.
What's not diving? Fortress fire.
It's a huge amount of damage.
You say they're not going to get the kill. He can blink over the wall. The Fortress don't fire. Zeratul can just blink over this wall.
Because none of the shots.
Illidan comes in again. They have no defender's advantage for the next 50 seconds. This is incredibly difficult to deal with.
And finally, there is at least a half level experience advantage for Reason Gaming.
Kel'thas is trying to just minimize damage at bottom lane.
We're going to have Zeratul. He actually might find Sheraz on that Abatha in top lane. He's just going to walk past him. Oh no, he's burrowing.
Oh no, he's going to get away. Oh, the Void Prison.
That bad man.
He doesn't interrupt it though. Look, his cast bar is still there.
But he'll...
Oh!
He cancelled it himself.
Yeah.
He cancelled it himself. What a misplay.
Yes.
Oh my god.
That's a panic click right there. Played, Zeratul. Finds the Abatha, kills the Abatha.
I mean, the Abatha knew he was there. Just a bit of map sense. You could see him there and to come out of the bush at that point.
What this means for Reason Gaming, well, it doesn't mean as much anymore, but what it did mean is during the curse now, they can just press wherever they want. They have Abathas down, they can really do anything. They can, and they most likely will do it.
Yeah. And Illidan has been spotted out there. They've managed to get the stun
on him. Oh,
that's
a great dive. Illidan does have the swipe. Zeratul getting killed by the Rhaegar up in top lane.
Wow.
Apologies for missing that. I wasn't expecting that to happen.
Fantastic play. Illidan's
going in.
This engagement's still going.
That's a great stun.
It's not a 3v4 because the Abatha's still there. It is the 4v4 fight.
Yeah, really well played there from everyone. Fortunately, apologies for missing that Zeratul death. But you don't expect Rhaegar to be able to do that kind of stuff. With an Abatha on your team.
Especially if he's not 13, he doesn't have Feral Lunge yet. So
no.
That's a huge chunk of Rhaegar's damage if he opts for it. We do actually get the web wrap out of Anubarak. So most ultis are pretty predictable. We have Metamorphosis for Illidan, Ultimate Evolution for Abatha, Phoenix, Ancestral Healing, Blessed Shield, Cocoon, some Water Elementals, Jug for Thousand Cups, Hinterland Blast, as predictable, and we've already seen that big boy.
So the standard stuff, nothing
completely
too
standard.
Crazy.
The builds are mostly all standard now as well. We've got the Spell Shield actually coming out for Anubarak. Makes sense against the Kael'thas.
And at this stage in the game, as with most stages, in Games of Heroes, you have this kind of not much happens phase, and I've said this way too many times already today. But at this point, you want to get position. Yeah. You want to get position on the next tribute, which is there is mechanics behind it, but I haven't been keeping track of them. The players are obviously better than I am at this game. They'll be keeping track of these. They're meeting up with Zeratul down here, which means they're going to go as a five for a little while.
The best thing Reason Gaming are looking for is more pickoffs. If they get the pickoffs, they extend their lead. But because of the soaking from Abatha and this push up top lane, the experience lead is completely equal almost.
But Falstad has found Rhaegar.
I see.
They might go and commit to this kill, or they could
But there's a big fight happening in mid lane.
Oh, I like that Blizzard. That Blizzard's incredibly good. Great condemn there. Where is the Abatha? The Abatha's in Johanna. I heard it go off. I couldn't see it for a little while.
Nubarak just taking a good chunk of damage, but Lili will be able to...
He's a tank. That's what he does.
Yeah, that's what he's meant to do.
doing a very good job of it as well. Lili's not in, in the best way. Unfortunately, not enough. The Anticipation Hill does die. Illidan coming in. This is going to be big damage.
That's a huge condemn.
He's coming in with a mop. He's just cleaning everything up. And now they have to retreat from this. There's no way they can secure this. And the Eagles, once again, have an experience lead.
There was even a web wrap. I think it was on the Kael'thas, wasn't it? He dropped the Phoenix and then he got web wrapped. It was Johanna.
Oh, this is cheeky. Oh, I like it.
I like this a lot. Especially with the Avatar helping out, Zeratul's going to come and spot him.
And Illidan for a couple of hits, still have Metamorphosis. But he's not that high. His health is pretty low.
Oh, he wormholes back.
He gets the Kael'thas, but trades one for one. Thalstead is here.
Wow. The Void Prism was trying to lock him out, missed the Illidan.
The boss is still going on. Thalstead needs to be careful. If he gets hit by that stun, it's probably curtains.
This
is a 1v1. He doesn't want to be in the situation, Falstead. He really doesn't want to be in the situation.
Although the Jaina is coming back.
Illidan's not quite there. Illidan needs to be careful. Great Burrow Charge.
Actually, he missed the Illidan with that, but the Impale's going to get him in the Illidan.
It got him in range. Too many people will just go for him. Yeah. Went in front and went for the body block. Brilliant. Really well played.
Even trades, 2 for 2. But Eagles got their first tribute of the game.
Which is big.
They're finding their stride in this match. They've started off a bit shaky. Yes. Reason really dominating with that Zeratul, but I mean, they now have the experience advantage. It's 9 to 6 kills. It's no longer a 5-kill deficit. It's only 3.
And it's about to get the 16. It's about to hit 16. Yeah. And the first thing that
Eagles are going to hit it
has
first.
A big advantage.
Yeah, 16 is you've got your big talents like your Blood for Blood and your Stone Skins. And
then 20 is following that as well, which is incredibly difficult to keep a lead up to 20. But if it can be done, you will most likely win the game. So this tribute here, it's a good spawn for Reason Gaming. They are nearby.
Yeah, they've just taken their hard camp, so fantastic spawn for them. They're going to be able to set up here. I don't know, for Eagles. I don't know whether or not Reason Gaming, they're close, but...
Oh, the classic Duke. Let's dance. Burrow Charge in on the Rhaegar. Not going to be able to do too much. Now, Anubarak's way overextended.
Yeah,
he's getting blasted down by everyone.
Escape.
He's completely overextended.
But Rhaegar is web wrapped.
He's still alive somehow. Stun's coming in from everywhere. Anubarak's dropping.
Juggernaut Talzin comes and pops.
Jaina getting great condemn there. Really forcing the Jaina to just nowhere to go.
Yeah.
Zeratul's still in stealth. He's not been able to make a
double Illidan in on this Lili.
Lili's trying Lili with that Kung Fu hustle.
The real Illidan's going to have to dive over this wall.
That's a great Void Prison now. Yeah. He might be able to clear everything up. Not quite, not today.
But again, that was that a 3 for 1. They got rid of the old ultimate evolution Illidan and they killed the real Illidan. But he'd already done all the work he needed to. They got 3 kills, they got the tribute, and they even got a fort down bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Which is lovely play by
Japan. They're going to try and grab a fort up top as well, out of ammo. 3 fort, why not? Let's press the advantage even further.
That's all 3 forts gone. Bang, bang, bang. Now, I mean, Eagles have only lost the 1 fort, so. They've
gone right the way back up.
Yeah.
They're 9 for 10 now.
It's a 1-kill deficit. They are a full level ahead, maybe even level and a half soon. They've got all 3 forts down.
Oh, Zeratul needs to be careful. If someone finds Zeratul, he's probably dead. Good blink, great one, hold back. The essential healing is good. Just keep him alive, Zeratul dies. Now it's 2-on-2. Everyone in the game is collapsing upon this position.
Yeah, we've got actually 4 heroes.
One's helping Falstead. And he just gets completely cut out. And Rhaegar, if he so chooses, can just go for him and run away. Great stun from the Kael'thas. Great Blizzard to follow up.
Not even thoroughly taken. It's just the extra movement speed from the Ghost Ball. Get in there, Hexer, 100% right click. And that's it. In fact, Illidan's found the Jaina. And that is all she wrote for the Jaina. She is dead.
Mm.
Wow.
Four for nothing.
13 for 10. They swung the other way around.
They've just found their stride and they've just really... This is what I'm talking about in this map. You press the advantage. You get a small lead and you just run with it. And you do not stop running with it until you win the
Reason
game.
Had that good early game advantage.
Great early game advantage.
It just all swung once the ultimates came in. And I did warn that, obviously, once Illidan's able to get that extra survivability, it can be really, really detrimental to the opposing team. The web wrap, I don't think it's been used as well as it could have.
And this is just salt in the wound at the moment.
Yeah.
Getting the hard camp as well. Shoving every lane. They have to defend with 0 health.
Boss
this is
with
all
a curse.
Players. Yeah, this is... The only thing which can stop this push happening is the players. And they have to have 5 people defend 3 lanes. Abathur getting picked off somewhere.
Not sure how that happened. I think he got a bit too overzealous.
Yeah, probably.
Oh, Zeratul found him in the bottom lane.
Oh, that'll happen.
And,
Illidan being caught out here.
So, a good kill, but a keep has fallen down. I think Abathur for a keep is a decent trade
for
most games.
If they're killing Abathur, they're not defending. And Abathur, while it's a great pick to get, what can you do?
Look what's happening bottom lane. Johanna and a huge minion wave are just pushing that keep. So in fact, they may even lose all three.
And Zeratul comes down to defend, but there's not much really Zeratul can do. Jaina, on the other hand, can deal big damage.
Yeah.
Really push away. And
half damage done, two keeps dead. That's a phenomenal curse.
And the thing about Abathur, which is different from all other heroes, which is really good, is Abathur respawns and is instantly in the fight.
Yeah.
No other hero can do that.
Brightwing, and on some maps, Falstaff.
Even Brightwing, there's a little time. And with Falstaff, there's a little bit of time as well.
Yeah, the Falstaff's got the flight and it has a limited range.
Yeah, there's a little bit of time. With Abathur, there's nothing.
Symbio on. Yeah. Let's go.
And then now they can just grab
another
one. And
we have level 20 out for Eagles.
So they kept the advantage, the small advantage that they get. Spiraled out of control and have found themselves two levels up. They have 20. And the other team only has 18.
Yeah, I mean,
talent's
quite reasonable here. Normally got blood for blood outfield instead of
Johanna looking to maybe force a fight here. But knowing that they have level 20s, Reason Gaming do not want to fight this at all. But Eagles will just look for a fight.
Gone with Storm Shield over the upgraded ancestral healing. Half the team's melee effectively because you know Abathur doesn't really count. What do you think of that? Because I think actually Storm Shield's better. It helps deal with a lot of burst.
I like it. What I really like is that Johanna has gone for indestructible.
Yes.
And that because Johanna can take Storm Shield. So that means that. Oh, meanwhile, Zeratul getting caught up by a stun. That's really not.
That boss stun.
Oh, it's a great blink away, though. Really punishing it. But Jaina getting here. Jump 1,000 cups is going to keep it alive. Great Void Prison.
Knocks out the boss and the Rhaegar, so there's no ancestral healing.
Yeah, there's no healing
moment.
Coming up. But Zeratul getting so incredibly low.
Illidan coming in with his broom. He's cleaning
up. Getting so low.
About to heal herself up.
But how can they defend this? Can they defend this? Really? It's going to have to be hectic defending. Everyone's been hit by dots.
I mean, the Hinterland Blast came out, but it didn't do anything.
Oh, that's great play.
And that is a GG.
And that's GG.
Well played. Eagles taking it 2-0 so far. In this best of five. Wow, well
really
played
well
by them.
Played.
I don't know what to say. I mean, what was it? Reason Gaming, they got a really good early game advantage. And somehow they just lost it. One team fight, they swapped, they lost. It ended up being a 4-2, I think, in this massive exchange. Quite a long exchange, and they got the tributes, and then they just carried on from there.
They found themselves with a tiny little advantage, and they just ran with it. And they never stopped pushing until they finally actually won the game.
Yeah, definitely. And I just think that it's Eagles. Whilst we have our top seed of recent game, they're showing that it's not all about who's predicted the most. They really found their stride once they hit about level 10, 13.
So Eagles have found themselves 2-0 up, and before the third game, we are going to take a quick 10-minute break. So don't go anywhere, and we'll be right back.
Yes. Okay, hello, welcome back. We are going into game three of our best of five, potentially the last game. It's fine, we'll go back to the other one. Yeah,
back to the other one?
Yeah, we're fine. We can jump into the draft because that should be going underway.
Yeah.
Excellent. So, sorry about that little delay. We're going to hop into the draft as soon as possible. This map is Tomb of the Spider Queen. Map we saw in the semis, I believe.
Very, very small map. Very explosive.
Yes. There's a lot of shadows, a lot of little alleyways you can go, some smoked areas.
Yes, a lot of ganks.
Yeah, we spoke a lot the last time we had it, how good Lyoric is in this map, and just quickly cover the bans and picks.
Yes, it looks like Kael Thas got banned instantly, and then Uther.
Again, that respect ban. But they didn't pick up Zeratul.
No.
They went straight for that Lyoric, and that's because he is so much better in this map.
And I think it was because they tried the Zeratul, and it didn't work out for them.
Yeah.
It was
great in the early game, but there wasn't enough that he could do to help, and Eagles eventually then picked up that.
Yeah.
That second game.
And now you have this kind of... I like Zagara here, by the way. I think Zagara is a very nice pick.
We know Reason really values Zagara over a lot of other...
So,
a lot of others.
Lyoric on this map is kind of like a key pick.
Yeah. Yeah, no, he's very much up there. In fact, we're going to get a really early Malfurion pick from Reason Gaming.
Too easy to counter and a little bit...
I mean,
hopeful, shall we say, that
normally
you won't be countered.
Normally you'd expect a Rhaegar pick. But that may be Reason are planning on banning out the Rhaegar. Because they get a ban now.
Yes.
So they don't have a support, they'll ban out the Rhaegar.
And Uther's already gone.
And Uther's already gone, banned out by Eagles themselves. So Reason are drafting smart here if they ban out the Rhaegar. That's making Eagles shoot themselves in the foot for taking away their Uther.
Does that open up someone? They have banned Zeratul now.
Yeah.
Zeratul made it far without getting picked.
Yeah, I think Eagles weren't particularly keen on picking him up over Johanna.
Or Jaina.
Yeah, or even Jaina.
Both of which I think are incredibly powerful on this map.
Yeah, and as predicted, we see that Rhaegar ban, which means he goes...
Who do you pick now? Who do you pick as your healer?
Oh, I would love to see Monk.
Yeah?
I really, really want to see Monk. I think Lili has been shown to be really strong. Her Jug of 1,000 Cups can...
It wins you games.
Yeah, it can make a break game. We are going to get the Lili. She's a bit more consistent, I think, as her healing output. And put her at level 20, Kung Fu Hustle, probably the single greatest talent in the entire game. Put it on any other hero and it's absurd. And it's still absurd with her.
So, Lili has a talent at level 13, I believe, that removes Roots, Slows, and Silences.
Yeah, Cleansing Brew from her heal. Every time she gets to heal, it removes them and gives them a 20% movement speed buff for 2 seconds, I believe.
So, she then is an incredibly good pick against Malfurion and against Nioh.
With the Roots and the Slows. It also means that the other heroes might not be as effective if they go for, say, I don't know.
Well, yeah, with Lili's kit, she comes with a blind, remember?
Yes.
Yeah, so auto-attack heroes like Darkstead, Valor, and Rayna.
Rayna. Yeah,
it's a very interesting ban. Obviously, Eagles are 2-0 up at this stage, so they can afford to take a more experimental approach.
And as we see, we get Rayna. He's not a common pick, but he is very strong in the right hands.
Yes.
And you'll see it constantly. You'll see a Rayna do absolutely top damage, without a doubt, if played well.
Yeah.
So we're going to have Reason Gaming pick up a Vala.
I'm not sure how much I like this, because Vala has a low health pool. She does have the Vault, which is obviously incredibly good, but with the Blessed Shield and the Condemn from Johanna, Vala's very easy to be picked off, and Lili can just mitigate your damage, only for a little while, but when you're at 10 stacks, of Vala's hatred, which is of course her trait, you can... that can really help.
And you've got to remember, Reason Gaming, they are fighting. They're
to
fighting
stay in this
to
tournament.
Stay in. This is potentially the last game of
before
this best
this
of
game
five.
Hadn't dropped a map. And now they find themselves 2-0 down.
2-0 down after being favourite, the top seed.
Yes, the top seed.
And they pick up a Tyrande. I'm not too sure how well she works with their composition, but she's never a bad pick. And I was about to say something about a Nova pick. I was actually going to suggest it maybe for Reason, pick off the Lili, but no, we get a Nova pick for E-Girls.
I would say
risky, but no, it's just explosive, it's aggressive.
On Tomb of the Spider Queen, she is crazy strong.
Yeah.
Like,
she
absolutely
definitely,
crazy strong.
Because, as we've mentioned, there's loads of little alleyways and there's the smoke, all these smoke areas, and she can just snipe over walls from basically anywhere. She can hit mid lane from a wall near bottom lane. It's crazy.
And she has that burst. At level 20, the burst she has...
Rewind. Now, do we see Hollow Decoy damage... plus double deco, or do we see pinning shot amplify damage? That's a more likely one.
I like pinning shot amplify damage. And the double decoy is it's so confusing.
I'm a big fan of the double decoy. You get five Novas running around, you're like, well, I just give up.
Yeah.
Rage flip your table.
yeah. If you see a table going over.
And if Reason Gaming had picked up Nova, if Nova was against the Lili, you've got to remember, Lili is blind.
Yeah.
And that nullifies most of Nova's damage.
Because Nova's damage is like, Nova's auto attacks take ages.
And on top
ages.
Of that, E-Girls have the Johanna, they have the blinding tank as well.
Yes.
So there's a lot of blinds from...
It's going to be so difficult. And Tyrande, remember, most of Tyrande's damage does come from auto attacks outside of her Lunar Flare. So it's going to be a very good game. And it looks like we are going to jump into it, so we will be on the loading screen momentarily. And be honest, E-Girls are 2-0 up. What chance do you give them of sweeping the clear favourites here?
I prefer Reason's draft this time. I do. I think they have a little bit more standard, but seeing a Nova in a grand finals, potentially a winning match, if done really well, most likely Precision Strike over Triple Tap, but if we get Triple Tap, that's going to be phenomenal. I can't overstate that enough. But yeah, we're going to have E-Girls here, the blue team on the left, Sheriz, that Johanna in base spinning around with the money pig. Gonna have Clued on the Lili, Lanel Delcrae playing the Nova, good old Lanel Delcrae, so cray cray. Myth is playing, I forgot what hero that is now, the Jaina, and we're gonna have Shaw on the Rayna.
And we are gonna have Skiver on the Leoric, Mirus on the Valor, Slam Jam on the Malfurion, In Vain on the Tyrande, and Siege on the Zagara.
Yeah, Siege, he likes the Zagara, he seems to be solid Zagara.
Yeah? It seems very good. So, I like putting Zagara in bottom lane. I like putting Zagara in bottom lane ahead of anything else because of that goop, the creep that she can spread. And it means that if you leave her alone, which you will do, because she won't really put pressure on your turrets, because they are surprisingly far apart. You look at bottom lane, and it's just everything.
Yeah, there's a fight happening mid. We've got a big blizzard great coming blizzard. Down on the Malfurion, and he's just about able to survive. Oh. Super low health. Well, I'm thinking sub 20 there. Just barely gets out, but no kill for E-Girls. Reason, they're holding on. Fighting, we've got that. It's that huge Nova burst damage, you see. Oh, and the snipe coming out and doing so much damage.
Oh my god.
Surviving on even less health that time. Crazy. She got the self heal off. And, I mean.
That's two lives down.
They should become cat gaming. Yes. Nine lives of barely dying. Another snipe hitting that Varlet, just taking it down. It does. At this point, it's not even as powerful, nearly as powerful as it's going to be. And it's already chunking for like a quarter of their health, if not more.
I find that, Nova has a kind of a reverse bell curve in terms of snipe damage. Mm. At level 1, hits like a truck. And that level's like 4 to 10. It doesn't hit that hard. Yeah. And then after that, it really starts to
help.
I imagine that has a lot to do with gathering power.
Your 13 talents are very important. Gathering power, whilst it got changed, nerfed, let's say, it's still a strong talent. It's still going to be good on Nova if she doesn't die. And even if she does, it's not as detrimental as it used to be, since you only lose some of the stacks.
Yes. Not all of them, you only lose half.
Yes.
It's a very generous half, apparently.
Yeah.
Well, rounds up.
It is a very, very generous half. I've had 10, I've gone down to 8.
Oh!
So, little bit of an engagement every now and then. Zagara, she's spreading her creep. Typically, she's gone with the Reconstitution, which is 200% bonus health regen while she's on it. Also moves a little bit faster on it, and she's just going to love it there and sit in that lane. We are having Jaina fall really low mid, gets hit by that Lunar Flare, but not going to die. Myth keeping himself alive.
Ooh, Johanna.
Johanna walking through.
Needs to be careful. There's four people in this lane.
Yeah, there's nobody soaking top, but that...
Eagles have already got a little lead.
Yeah. Eagles, they've already got the experience lead. They've had that Lili soaking top lane constantly. And Reason Gaming, they were four in mid, but they've not done the thing where you clear out the creep wave middle, and then you just run top, clear out that creep wave as four. If you move as four like that,
Reason
very
that.
Strong. We did see Reason do that, and they're not doing it this time.
Despite I wonder why.
Kind of moving towards it. I wonder what the reason is.
Yes, I wonder what the reason.
Please.
Do you think
me.
It's a respect thing? They think, nope, we can't do that.
Oh, we've got Avala taking a lot of damage here. We got slowed by the Jaina, sniped, and good condemned. Block her out. First blood for E-Girls on Reason's Vala.
Vala getting... I mean, it's not often you see Vala being caught out of position in the lane like that.
They were super far forwards. About here, the Leoric able to walk there. Vala went down there, got hit by the cone of cold, and that slow was just too much.
The vault can quite often get you out of very sticky situations. And of course, in this time, it was either on cooldown or just not enough.
So we see a small party bush here, but the Trondale, I think, will just clip Myth there. It didn't hit him, but I think the vision just clipped.
Oh, Jaina.
And Jaina has been caught out. Dodges the stun very well.
That's very good juking.
As well.
Really good juking there.
Ran down to where her team was, were able to avoid the stun and the root. And in fact,
Leoric's
taking
the
Leoric
needs to be very careful. The short walk was not short enough.
Not enough. And
this is Leoric. We'll come back momentarily.
Yeah, Jaina taking a bit of damage from the multi-shot. Falling low, going to have to half back.
And Leoric is back in the mid lane.
Just kind of watching this Nova, seeing what she's going to be able to do. Interestingly, she's taken remote delivery, which reduces the cooldown of Hollow Decoy instead of something like
and
gathering power. Yeah.
Maybe Nova doesn't think this the gathering power is good enough anymore.
Yeah, I mean, we already see Nova's done way more hero damage than anybody else on the team.
Early game, she'll do that.
Yeah.
I want to bring attention to Reyna's creep clearing in the lower lane here.
Oh, yeah.
Zagara's been doing an amazing job of keeping those creep chambers on cooldown, as far as I'm aware. Yeah. And Reyna's just been taking them out as soon as they spawn. Just really making a very good...
I mean, Johanna's coming in every now and then and clearing out one with shield flare. Mm-hmm. Stuff like that. But as long as they keep that creep under control, that's a lot of vision that you're denying from a Zagara player who's used to the vision to protect her almost. Mm-hmm. It's like having an escape, being able to see when anybody's coming at any point in time.
It's like it's a better scouting drone, some people have said. A much better scouting drone.
Oh, I agree. I think scouting drone is... I mean, it's seen its play and it's had its moment, but... It's not quite a good enough talent for a lot of supports compared to, or a lot of people who can take it compared to their other choices.
Malfurion can take it, and it makes for very interesting pug games when people can see ganks coming from two lanes away and still don't retreat.
Well, E-Girls do have a...
It's going to be a quick pause here.
I'd say they have an almost full level advantage. We've got a quick pause coming out.
Yes.
I want to say, not going to have some sort of alternating ability and then attack build out of the Nova.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have anti-armor shells.
Pierce.
Okay.
From the Tyrande.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. What do you normally go with? I don't play much.
Okay, so, well, she's going for the owl build. Normally, I think... Oh, I'm trying to remember. Healing Ward or
yes.
Protective Shield.
Healing
and normally once you take a level,
level
4.
The shield.
And at level 7, you'll then get... forgotten what it's called.
Oh, we're really bad at this game.
The Lunar Flare Extra Range.
Oh, yes, that one. And then at 10, you get Starfall. And
thank
then
God I played Tyrande recently.
Oh, God, I haven't played Tyrande in ages. She's all for fun, though.
Yeah. A lot of fun. I do like the Owl build, because you can get some fantastic across the, map, just the double Rewind Owl. Rewind Owl.
Owl, Rewind Owl, and Abatha dies.
Yeah, Abatha dies no matter where he
Brilliant.
Is. Just, oh, it's so good.
Yeah. I also like this build from the Oric. He's taken Fealty Unto Death, which is when a nearby minion dies, you gain a little bit of health and a little bit of mana, even while undying. So that means that you can res incredibly quickly. Mm. But remember, in the most recent patch, all of Leoric's undying effects made him res faster were all reduced by 50%.
Yeah, which was it was needed, let's say.
Yes, it was, entirely.
Even with that nerf, he still
comes up quick.
Yeah, he's still a highly banned, highly sought after, highly picked tank, as we've seen him in every game. Same with the Johanna. Absolutely crazy. And we get the stereotypical Johanna build coming out, still the battle
momentum
and all that. I just see the Rainer's build because he's not the most common pick.
Season Marksman. I like it as an idea. But you don't get that many stats.
It misses something at the moment. It needs something else. And we've been asking for it for a long time, Season Marksman, just to be made a little better.
Mm-hmm.
But we do see it on Rainer because it is still good on him.
Yeah, it's good. I remember a time when give me more.
Yes.
The one that increases, it may mean if you died, you could just tank for a while.
Definitely.
So, you know, it's fine.
But
now, Season Marksman getting picked. Focus attacks getting picked as well, and fight or flight.
Yeah, I mean, I quite like Rainer's Raiders, his bribe, version of bribe.
Oh,
it's
yes.
It's good. It's only costs 15 bribe stacks instead of the 20.
Mm-hmm.
You up to the maximum of 50 as normal bribe, but it does mean that you can take 3 mercenaries, which is almost an entire hard camp,
yeah.
and on Battlefield on the Diablo-themed map.
Yes, you
that
can
is an entire hard
yeah.
camp and an entire siege camp, and it makes him, I think, that talent particularly strong on those maps.
On this particular map, though, however, there is only one siege giant camp,
yes.
and that's in the bottom lane. So you can bribe it, but
This map's not great for mercenaries.
No, not at all. it's more like the objective. It's a very objective-centered map.
I mean, they're not even the strongest objectives, but the fact that it's based on denying your opponent's objective by killing them,
mm-hmm.
making them drop their gems, and then nobody gets to pick them up.
Mm-hmm.
You only get 3 from the hero kill, you don't get any of the gems they're holding.
So, it appears to be a communication issue, so there's no massive panic.
No, it's not a panic.
People are lagging.
Storm
oh,
died.
No,
We've
yes.
got the server messed
so
up.
So it's a minor issue, so I imagine it will be fixed momentarily. And this, while we're on the game screen here, let's have a look at the positions of everyone. So if you look here, you have 3 of Reason Gaming.
In the mid lane.
In the mid lane. And Leoric as well, who is very much alive. And there's 2 from Eagles.
No.
3 from Eagles, rather.
Yeah, I mean, the Nova's coming in. Well, she's heading down a little bit, but you've almost got the entire team, because right below is the
mm-hmm.
is the Zagara Siege. He's just sat there. So what are you thinking? When we unpause, we're going to have... Reason Gaming come across to the right.
There's always a Kappa. I haven't made it through a day in my life without a Kappa these days. So,
thankfully, my friends aren't that terrible to
oh
me.
Oh, God.
They're not bad people.
So, what I want to see is Shaw here on the Rainer go to turn in. And I want to see them interrupt the Zagara turning in as well. I want to see E-Girls do both of those things. Because while Reason have the advantage kind of up in the top right of the 2 that are in mid lane, they have the advantage of the Zagara who's going to turn in.
Yeah, I mean, the Zagara turn in's not crucial. It'll bring them to 32 out of 50. But sure, he has more than enough
mm-hmm.
To hand in. They're already on 41 out of 50. And overall on the team, they've got 39 gems that they can hand in at this point, with a lot of them being on the Lili and most of the rest of them being on the Rainer at this point. A couple divvied out kind of here and there.
Mm-hmm.
But and there is enough on the entire side of Reason to hand in, but they're just kind of lacking gems overall.
Yes.
And I think the 2 kills definitely helped. It scared them a little bit, that Nova play, the burst damage coming out of her, picking off those squishies, Tyrande,
mm-hmm.
Vala, and until Malfurion gets Ice Block, Malfurion is an easy target.
I remember playing some Jaina games, and especially against the Nova, who of course you see all the time in solo queue.
100%.
You will, you feel like you're just about to die, always about to die, and then once you get that Ice Block, it gives you a weird power spike.
Almost, yeah, because yeah. I mean, it's really strong with Malfurion in particular, because even if you ice block, the tranquility still goes. Your healing ultimate still surrounds you, still heals allies, and that's a phenomenal change, because it used to just pause it a short while ago now, but now that it keeps it going.
Because it's an area of effect.
Yeah, it is an effect. Yes. Yeah. I mean, which makes Devouring Maw and Web Wrap so powerful. Against Malfurion, because it doesn't have the AoE effect. You are so phased out of the game.
So the differences are during an ice block, and it doesn't affect Void Prism, does it?
In the Void, it just pauses it, nothing happens.
So it looks like we are back into the game. Excellent. So we're going to the screen in just a second. And it looks like all of what we predicted would happen, none of it happened.
We maybe saw a gank, but no. I think E-Girls, good game sense, they saw it coming and just moved out of the way.
Yeah, yeah. There's no reason to take any risks. The Oryx is taking a risk.
taking a good chunk of damage, but he's Leoric, he's fine.
The drain hope.
Basically as much as he wants.
Oh,
Siege just coming back, the Nova revealing herself. I think at this level, you'll be able to see the Nova shimmer. I don't think there's ever going to be an issue with that, so they should see her coming. But there's much smoke on this map that it's good to hide her.
That Johanna play there to guard the Lili while she was turning in is obviously it's simple, and you would expect it, but quite a lot of times, you don't see that kind of pushing forward. In some of the games that we cast today, you saw people pulling back or going at a different angle, and they weren't protecting their team, and they would score a pick and then lose what they were trying to do in the first place. So it's just very nice to see that kind of cohesion.
Oh, another pause, please.
It's level one, is it?
No. It's like buses.
That's the one.
You wait for one, and then
two turn
20
up.
Minutes later, two turn up. How old are we?
So
it seems to be another issue with TeamSpeak.
Yeah, a little communication there.
Which is fine. It'll be all right. Might have to move into a different thing, but we're going to have... I mean, we still have that experience advantage.
Yeah. Just so everyone knows, it's 8 level and 8 level. Oh, yeah, so they're level 8 and level 8.
But we're like 2 creep kills for E-Girls to be level 9, and it's not a whole talent, so it's not the end of the world. But
Reason Gaming... to level 10, which is a big deal.
Need to gain some sort of kill momentum to catch up. They don't want to get level 10 1 minute behind. Yep. They want to get it 10 seconds behind at like most. You don't want to leave a team having that ultimate, so you literally can't engage. You have to stay as far away as you can on the map. And they have a Nova to beat Invis to go behind the lines. I mean, on the map, they've got all these little alleyways. You can't see
it. Oh, those alleyways.
You've got alleyways behind all the walls. And for the forts in particular, I mean, there's none for the keeps, which is okay. But for the fort, if you can just... have a way to get around. Now, I think it is on every map there is a way, but it means that Nova can sneak around and just pick somebody off and run away. And every single map has it.
And I think that's one of the subtle advantages, not many people pick up on, of the double decoy. By that time, you don't really have too many forts alive, but you can kind of exploit the double decoy by having one decoy, that gets killed by a fort, and the other decoy gets killed by the cannon tower or something, but the real Nova is killing everything.
Yeah.
For some reason, the chat has now descended into talking about Hearthstone, and particularly Lord Jiraxxus.
Well, he's in World of Warcraft initially.
Yes.
Back in the arena. I remember doing that raid, legit. It's good times, good times. But yeah, I think... So who are you favouring now? Obviously, E-Girls have
I like
their
E-Girls.
Advantage.
E-Girls with the... E-Girls with the... The Webweavers pushing up the lane, and they have, if you look at the positions, obviously you can't, but the positions of most of the spiders and the minions, and thus where the spiders will spawn, particularly in the top lane, is very close to that fort. And that will allow for a much, much better shove.
Yeah.
Down in bottom lane, definitely. 50-50, and in mid lane, as you can see, it is just about to spawn just behind the line. And I quite like that, because what can happen sometimes is if there's one archer minion and a whole wave of other minions, the Webweaver will run up to your one archer minion and then start spawning, and the enemy minion wave will push forward and they will spawn in the enemy minion wave. And you gain literally almost no advantage from that at all, because the enemy team can just swarm over and just kill everything.
Yeah. Especially, like, as we said, the Webweavers are coming down, and that's going to extend... E-Girls experience. There's very little Reason Gaming can do at all to stop them getting 10 a good chunk before, but as we said, you really don't want that.
No.
Just going to quickly bring up the scoreboard here.
Yeah, let's look at the scoreboard.
One death for Vala, one death for the Leoric.
What I'm most interested in is the siege damage here.
Okay.
So if you look at the two tanks, they have a considerable amount of siege damage.
Yeah, I mean, knight takes pawn, obviously, for Johanna.
And you expect it, so you expect it to go specialist, your specialist lane pusher, or anyone who's just dedicated lane pusher this game, and then assassins, and then warriors, and then supports. And that's kind of what we see here. But Leoric's siege damage is considerably higher than Zagara's, and Zagara's been sitting in lane.
Yes. I mean, Leoric even died.
Yes.
And he's still got a huge amount. Zagara's siege damage is, I mean, it's 8k behind.
Yes, it's 8k. Which, in the grand scheme of things,
he's a Malfurion behind.
Yes. Isn't that much. But it's quite interesting, just to show the kind of the playstyle. That means that the Leoric's been going, moving about a lot.
Going from lane to lane. Going up to creep waves, doing a big skeletal swing.
And, I mean, even if you look at hero damage, I know when it comes to hero damage at this stage...
We're 6 minutes in, 2 kills have happened, it's not a big...
Yes.
But...
But, it's very interesting to see when you see that Reason Gaming's hero damage, the Valor and the Leoric are up there, and the Tyrande is lagging behind. Now, she is a support, first and foremost, so she's not going to be as much damage, but she does get a spot. Watch that number. Watch the Tyrande's number, and watch the Valor's number. They will scale out of control, but they will come back together, and they will end... Kind of similarly. Anyway, yeah, back to the game.
Definitely. So, just not much happening. I mean, Siege taking some harass damage from the Nova down in bottom. And the Webweaver's coming down. The one in mid lane is going to be completely cleared up, really easy. Shiraz not able to do much to protect it on the Johanna. But we've got Jayne and Lili up in top lane, doing a lot of damage to Tyrande. And that Webweaver.
They do have the red team coming in on them. The red team, of course, is Reason Gaming.
Yeah, in fact, Myth is getting caught out
here. Oh, it's a great Lunar Flare. That's got to be dead, right? He's dead, right?
The blind. Oh, almost gets a kill on the Tyrande and the Malfurion himself.
That would have been amazing.
All that cover damage, the crit from the frost.
And now they have level 10s. Eagles have level 10s.
Yep, and we've seen, we've got Precision Strike out. Yes, we're going to have that big global Nova ultimate come down and just rain hell on
When you're low, you're always in danger of death now.
In fact, we have Ring of Frost for Jayne, not Water Elemental.
It's interesting. That got buffed quite significantly, in fact, in the latest patch. The cooldown was significantly reduced. And with Water Elementals, the more I see it, the more I think it's a significant nerf. It's interesting to see that come together. Now, this map is very open. Ring of Frost does not play into that very well.
You say it's open. There is
a lot of choke points.
Yeah, there's choke points and smoke for potential gank.
Almost dies anyway.
Yeah, I think he just took a lot of damage from right clicks at that point. Almost nailed the Malfurion. Got out by the skin of his teeth. Just
a little bit further back to force a more awkward zone.
But
might have been able
as we see, the ultimates came out, and the only kill that was had was actually Reason Gaming getting the kill.
Not pressing the advantage. Ring of Frost. Oh!
Oh, that Ring of Frost. The damage that comes out of it. It does so much damage as well as freezing. It's only the one pulse initially. But that placement was so perfect. Any further forwards, and you just would have been in the middle. And
in the middle, unharmed. Yes. The middle doesn't go off. No. The middle little ring, which is where there's not any runes, you're fine in there. But yeah, the outside one.
Just that outside, just the circumference around it. Just
so really doesn't hit that hard. Hit that much.
In fact, actually missed a kill on the Vala.
Where was that?
Mid lane. The Nova able to
get the snipe out.
Nova coming in, probably a condemn.
Yeah, but it wouldn't surprise me. Vala and Vala against Johanna's never a good lane. Thrown over into the mix and Vala's not going to have a good time.
We have a lot of gems on the side of E-Girls, and they're actually going to hand in, and this might be the full hand.
Oh, unfortunately, the Zagara Roach things weren't just for sure.
Yeah,
it was a blind shot, I imagine, but just missed the Reyna. That would have been an amazing shot. It wouldn't have gone that much.
Taking a Nova right click and snipe combo, going down. In fact, the Zagara getting caught out. Nova's there.
This is the power that Nova gives you.
Yeah, I mean, all you need is Johanna plus Nova. The Johanna slows and does the
and
stun,
just
and then
gets
the Nova's
out of position.
Right there. Boom. Snipe, pinning shot, an extra slow, because they've got two slows between them and the condemn stun on top of that.
And in that time, she's dead.
Yeah.
She's not getting away from that. So Tyrande here needs to be careful. Nova is just going to seize this fort, which is why we're not just talking about Nova. Eagles in general are going to seize this fort, but Nova's not looking to get a kill at this point.
Yeah. And in fact, we do get an owl come out from Tyrande, and it hits on the Lili and the Nova with the pierce. So that's actually going to be pretty good. Leoric getting frozen by the Ring of Frost.
He does go on some Marginal Black King. That's an aggressive Wraith Warp with such low HP. That's ambitious. Great stun.
But that Tranquility keeping him alive really well.
Really well placed.
By the Malfurion. He's taken so much damage and the slows from Jayne. He's going to get picked off. Nice and easy.
I love that.
That was one. It's that massive orbital cannon that comes down.
And then the guy in it's always like,
Yeah.
Hammer of God style.
Brilliant.
We're going to have level 13.
This web weaver's still alive. It's
and in fact, even level 14 come out for e-girls. They still have this advantage. I'm getting really worried.
Stop dying,
games.
Vala!
Oh. Vala dying bottom, apparently. Oh, we've got the Jaina Nova. Into watch. I'm just going to watch
yeah,
Vala
watch,
for the motion.
Yeah.
Race walk there.
Oh, Tarantula's in a bad spot.
Yeah,
oh, she's
frozen.
Dead.
She's dead. Very dead. And there we go. We do actually get holo decoy damage. Lethal decoys.
Oh, good. Very good.
So we're going for
this
the
must
decoy
be double decoys.
Must
yeah.
be double decoys.
Yeah, the increased range. Yeah, that builds into
makes
it.
Makes absolute sense. Mm-hmm. And I like this ball. I personally
four
go gather power instead of remote delivery, but I
yes,
really,
so
really enjoyed this.
Three levels now.
Yeah, three. It's not a talent point advantage. It will be. Yeah.
Oh, no, it is still.
It is still, yeah, because of the 13.
13.
You still need it. It's almost a 2 talent point advantage, and that's
it will be.
A dire situation.
No, it won't. Will it? What do you
for
reckon?
Reason.
Reason needs to start earning experience.
We're going to have the siege camp take a bottom. I think I would have actually liked to see Eagles rotate up to potentially try to do the boss.
Look at it. Look at how annoying this Nova's going to be here. She's going to be able to throw down so many decoys and just auto-attack and just keep them from turning in. If Eagles find this and collapse on them, it should go well for them, obviously, because they have three levels. But you don't want to take that risk when you have a lead on a map like this. If you just keep pressing your lead, you'll end up winning.
As we can see, all of Eagles, they're kind of rotating, moving up. Maybe they were positioning to take the boss, but they ended up just going back down to mid. Get that hand in, get the web weavers, and they're going to push with it.
I think Reason are being a little bit...
They know that Reason here, the creep camp's not despawned.
Oh,
no.
They
understand they're not quite going to be able to take it. They're going to be walking
into
it. Johanna's
going to walk into the big precision strike.
Huge precision strike, and that Ring of Frost taking out Malfurion, the Zagara.
Massive march to the Black King.
Not going to do enough. Lyoric's going to fall. That is a 3-0. The Jug of 1,000 Cups coming out and keeping...
And now they have two talents on them.
Two talents, and they managed to take the hard camp. Lyoric, it was like...
It's not looking good.
Quite able to
it's
do
not
it.
Looking good at all for Reason Gaming.
Yeah, two talents. Almost back down to the one talent.
Remember,
13
Eagles are 2-0 up in this series. If they win this game, they win it all.
Yeah, and that's first, that will be first place for Eagles if they
yes.
win. But comebacks are always available.
This is a massive shove in mid lane.
Yeah. Tomb of Spider Queen is not necessarily the easiest map to come back on, but anything can happen, especially.
That's why the boss is there.
High
you can throw a game on a boss super easy.
Oh, definitely, definitely. We're going to see here, still not the level
dead.
16 talents picked, and most of them are level 17. There's double decoy finally being taken.
That keep's fallen.
We don't get cleansing through.
I would like to see Eagles here rotate down to the lower lane and
oh,
take
we do
out
get, we
that
do
key.
Get cleansing through at level 16, rather.
Oh, good.
Lily was just umming and ahhing, but I'll take a giant kill of Arena. Makes
yep.
sense against the Lyoric.
Mm-hmm.
And with a keep dead.
It should,
like
be should be two. Should be two. They should press this advantage before they retreat. If they lose anything before getting this keep, I will. And it doesn't look like they're going to. But in that situation, it's on half health. The gate is down, so you can escape. You really need to get as much as you can.
That's the second keep dead.
Yes.
And that is such a big advantage. They've still got to see
them
alive.
Four.
A huge ring of frost on the Zagara, rather. She doesn't have ice block.
Massive condemn.
Not able to get out of that.
Big
She's going to die. Huge march. Not going to do enough.
The ice
precision
block.
Strike
securing
comes
it.
Down.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it, right?
Eagles!
So. Going on!
Coming through, 3-0!
This is it! They win! They can't defend
gaming.
This!
GG, ladies well played by them!
Your Insomnia 55 Heroes of the Storm Tournament Open winners! Hopefully!
Yeah,
it all goes totally wrong!
2%, it's over!
Is Eagles! Congratulations!
Well done to them, fantastic play!
Who cares about seeding?
No, yeah, just. And they were one of the people who wanted, I think, to do the seeding at the start.
Ring of Frost! You don't often see that!
It did so much damage. I know it does a lot of damage, but it did a huge amount of damage. Yeah,
so, well.
So now the game's over, throw over to our presenter, Matt.
Matt Andrews on the stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, our winners are E-Girls of the Storm! A great battle across our best of three. Well done to both teams taking part in our final. And we'd like both teams to come up to the stage. On the line, please, everybody. On the line, please, guys. A great best of three final here at Insomnia 55 and our Heroes of the Storm Open. Congratulations to both of our two teams for making it to our final. Commiserations, of course, to Reason Gaming for coming as runners-up here. You win our £1,000 for coming runners-up in our final. A round of applause, please, for Reason Gaming. Reason Gaming, our worthy runners-up. Thank you very much for taking part, and congratulations to you for coming second here at Insomnia 55. And ladies and gentlemen, our winners of our Heroes of the Storm Open here at Insomnia 55 are E-Girls of the Storm! Congratulations to you. We'd like to just have a quick chat about that. Best of five, you won it in three straight games. So first map, that was Reason Gaming's choice. Were you confident taking that map off of them?
Which map was that? What was the first map? Black Hearts Bay. Yeah, actually, we were pretty happy when they picked that because we feel like we play Black Hearts really well compared to a lot of teams. We have a lot of comps that are good on that map specifically. We didn't actually use it today, but we like to use Sonya a lot, who is really good at doing bird camps. So, or I like to, they don't. but we just like played our game. We felt like we could just out-rotate them and take the objectives. And we didn't really need to fight them that map at all. We just won.
Just one. That's quite a confident but quite a clear way of doing things. And then second map was your choice, and I can tell you that Reason Gaming were very confident that it was going to be at least 2-1 going into 3-1. They were quite sure they weren't going to win that third and final map, but you turned that around really well. So you must be very happy winning this in three straight matches.
Yeah, we're pretty pleased. The second game was a bit ropey to begin with.
You had a sort of unconventional ban in that. Some people would say you banned against the grain. I know our casters were thinking that was maybe some unusual picks, but it turned out you really knew what you were doing.
I mean, the ban on Uther was basically a respect ban to them, because we know that he plays a lot of Uther and it works with Butcher, and that was just something we didn't want to have to deal with because we don't see that a lot. So by banning that, we were just able to play on our own terms. So yeah.
Well, it all worked out. 3-0 in a best of five. Ladies and gentlemen, our Heroes of the Storm finalists and winners here at Insomnia 55. E-Girls of the Storm!